Church of Pittsburg on this glorious Pentecost Sunday. This is the birthday of the church, only 1,989 years young. And I tell you, y'all don't look a day over 1,900. Looking good. Yes. So good to be back with you all here in sunny Pittsburg, Kansas. The reason why I'm wearing this mask, I know it's so 2021. We brought back several souvenirs from Florida. My least favorite was COVID-19, which Julie and I both tested positive for on Monday. So it has been a week. My quarantine ended yesterday, and I'm supposed to wear a mask in public for at least 5 days after that. So that's why this is going to stay on for a few days more, five, I don't know, whatever. What?
Thank you.
You're welcome. I thought about not coming today, but I was already on last Sunday, so I'm going to try really hard to stay away from everybody. The service is over. I'm just going to go into my office and shut the door and meditate. Chill. Yeah, meditate. That's a good idea. That's probably what I'll do. So that's what this is all about. Any announcements? Anybody have any announcements? Anything going on? Yay! Yes! Hot dog.
VBS was hugely successful. I might be slightly biased, but we had almost 50 kids every day, if not more than 50 kids. And 50! 5-0! I know! It was amazing! Thank you. So over 50 kids. The first day was 49. 51, 51.
49, 50, 52.
Okay, so 49, 50, 52.
Nice.
Averages out to 50. That's amazing. We're going to invite them all back again on this coming Wednesday for WOW! Worship on Wednesdays. So we're going to be using the basement. That means the basement is dug. And we will be revealing it on the Facebook page and on the screen. Hopefully we can get it all figured out for everybody after the second service. So you can check online or stick around, but hopefully we will have that so not everyone has to actually go down to the basement. They can just sit up here. Watch and see what it looks like. So make sure you check out those before pictures, because I was looking at them yesterday, and whew, it looks a lot better. It was very eye-opening to look at those pictures again after working in the basement for so long.
Amen.
So we're super excited about that. The worship on Wednesday, Mary Carol's asking for some cookies to feed the kids. I don't know, we might have 50. I don't know. So we'll be prepared. What was the other thing?
You want to tell them how much you collected?
Oh, that was it. We raised $191 for Salvation Army and collected over 1,000 water bottles. Did we recap?
1,148.
1,148 for the Lord's Diner. Because they were like out. So those are stacked in the sanctuary if you want to see how big our wall is. So thank you.
Amen. Yes. Water bottle tower is most impressive. All right. What else is going on? Anything else need to announce?
I'd like to thank everyone who worked with Bible school.
Oh, yeah.
When I was younger, I did it. I know. It's fun, but it's a lot of work.
Yeah.
And so if you worked anything, if you brought cookies and walked out the door, I didn't care. Thank you.
Amen. Yes, yes, yes. Yes, absolutely. Any other announcements? Anything else happen this week? How about joys or concerns? Any joys or pleasures?
I got a new car.
Yay! Way to go.
It's outside over here. It's the blue one.
Okay.
Nice.
Go look.
Okay. More than welcome to.
Nice.
You have to sign up for a ride.
I got to pay for it somehow.
How much does it cost?
How much are the rides?
That's my publicist back there.
Any other joys or concerns? All right. Well, I'm sorry, I'm so spacey. This medicine I'm taking is, I think that's one of the side effects of it, and it's one of the side effects of COVID, is a, you know, fogginess. We are worship now. I'm supposed to call you all to worship. So let's worship Almighty God on this day we celebrate the gift of His Holy Spirit. Please join me in affirmation of faith. I believe that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of the living God, and I confess Him as Lord and Savior.
Thank you.
Please pray with me. Gracious, loving man, Heavenly Father, give you thanks for this very special day. We remember the gift of your Spirit when it first came upon the disciples of Jesus in that upper room. Gave them the ability to speak to all people, people from all over the world. And from that, the mission began to the ends of the earth by the power of your Holy Spirit. Lord, we humbly ask that your Spirit be with us here today. Fill each and every one of us. Continue to guide us and lead us. Give us all that we need to fulfill your mission on earth. And maybe someday beyond. And today, Lord, we also give you thanks for our vacation Bible program. Thank you for all the children that we were blessed to have here. Thank you for all the volunteers, all the time and energy that went into it. We pray that those children learned something, some valuable things about you and about following Jesus. Lord, we also ask your blessing upon our wow events and everyone involved with those. We give you thanks, Lord, for all of the water bottles and the money that was raised. We give thanks that we're able to bless our neighbors here in Pittsburgh with our giving. We also give you thanks that the basement is done, and we give you thanks for all the many, many hours of work that went into it, especially all the time Marissa and Matt put into it. They got it going, they made it happen, they kept us going, and it's just such a blessing to see it completed. And we give you thanks for this, Lord. We pray that space will be a blessing for many, many children for years to come. And we give you thanks, Lord, also for Noah's new car. Pray that it takes her safely wherever she needs to go. And we give you thanks for all of this in the name of our Savior, Jesus Christ, who taught us to pray, "Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our sins, as we forgive those who sin against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen." All right, scripture from the Acts of the Apostles, chapter 2, verses 1 to 4. The word of the Lord. Excuse me. When the day of Pentecost had come, they were all together in one place. And suddenly from the heaven there came a sound like the rush of a violent wind, and it filled the entire house where they were sitting. Divided tongues as a fire appeared among them, and a tongue rested on each of them. All of them were filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak in other languages as the Spirit gave them ability. The word of the Lord. this precise moment, I'm sure you're all wondering, what is up with billionaires going to outer space? Right? Do they know something that we don't know besides how to make a whole lot of money? Maybe being able to buy your own personal island isn't enough anymore. I mean, the ultimate, in a way, outer space is the ultimate gated community. There is no more exclusive real estate on the planet than, you know, off the planet. And you won't have to worry about uncouth neighbors bringing down your property values for a long, long, long time. And how about the moon? How about the moon? I like the moon. I like looking at the moon. I heard we're going back to the moon. I mean, not us, but somebody is going to go to the moon. Like a rocket ship. Going to go up there again. Maybe put a base up there. I don't know. But I'm sure we all know, once enough people get up there, somebody is going to carve something in the face of the moon big enough for us to see it down here. We all know what's going to happen. And people will say, "Remember when the moon looked like the moon?" And that won't sound nearly as stupid then as it does now, because we'll know exactly what they're talking about. Doggone it. And sure, I love the idea of space travel. I have fantasized about it. As far back as I can remember, one of the high points of the trip my family went on the week before this last week was to the Star Wars part of Disney World. It was amazing. I got to go to the galaxy far, far away that I traveled to in books and movies and in my imagination. Got to fly the Millennium Falcon. That was pretty sweet. And I gotta tell you, the cast members in that part of the park are in character. Holy cow, I've never seen anything like that. I asked this lady, cast member, like why there was like this kind of gap between two buildings. And with this arch over it, and she was standing in front of it, in front of the podium, and I was like, "Hey, what goes on like in here?" And she said, "Oh, this is the arrival port for people." I don't know. She rattled it off like spaceships are going to land and people are going to come on. And she said it in a way that sounded like something out of a Star Wars book. I was like, "Right on, way to go, okay." I don't know, I should have worked on that one a little more. But anyways, space travel is cool. And because of it, because we have attempted, or we have journeyed off the planet, this has brought about great scientific breakthroughs and innovations that have benefited us right here on Earth. Things like the insulin pump, the LASIK eye surgery, solar cells, wireless headsets, camera phones, CAT scans, baby formula. They don't take babies into space, but they did it. I mean, they made the stuff. Air purifiers, memory foam, workout machines, portable computers, the computer mouse. All because we went to space. And that's just a fraction of the things that have been developed because of our travels off the planet. So leaving the planet has improved life on the planet. Now back to billionaires blasting off to the stars. Getting in on the ground floor of privately owned space travel may be a very good investment. Greatest investments of all time. I don't know. However, my initial thought regarding private citizens pouring billions of dollars into space travel was that it's selfish and tone deaf. Kind of like, Yeah, let's ignore all the problems here on earth and go somewhere else. When all those billions of dollars could do so much good right down here. But shooting for like those technological improvements that were made because we desired to travel off the planet, humanity ought to make improvements on ourselves before we move off the planet. I mean, why take our mess to the stars? Why go and hate each other and kill each other on another planet? Why not get it right, right here, first? But it's so true, wherever you go, there you are. And we all know how well some folks do with people from other countries here on Earth. How about folks from other planets? Imagine how that would work out. That, say, if people born on future colonies on Mars or the Moon or the moons of Jupiter or wherever out there. How? Just imagine what might happen to them if they were to come back or have relations with Earth somehow. I could hear people saying, "We don't need you Martians coming back here looking for handouts, tearing down Earth culture. Go back to your planet." If we could colonize other moons and planets right now, that would happen. There would be Earth-first political movements. We'd have spaceship babies instead of anchor babies. Yeah, just because you landed here, it doesn't make you a citizen. And there'd be all sorts of negative stereotypes associated with colonists and offensive names for them too, of course. And when the colonists would speak out against their unfair treatment, the unneighborly earthlings would call them snowflakes and accuse them of engaging in cancel culture and identity politics just because the colonists are working to be treated as equals with their earthling brothers and sisters. And then there's always the possibility of war. And I know that all sounds incredibly cynical, but from what I see every day in the news and want to know human history, that's pretty much par for the course. So thank goodness we're not technologically ready to colonize outer space, because humanity's not ready. But the goal is helpful, and reaching it with our hearts in the right place may be just one small step for an enlightened, loving man or woman, but it will certainly be a giant leap for mankind. And I think I've got a step here that will help us take that leap. It's like if you're preparing to move to a new house, a new residence, and you find something that's broken, but you've had it for years and years, and maybe it's fixable, maybe not. That's why you didn't throw it away immediately when it broke. You were going to think about what to do with it later, so you shoved it in a corner in the basement with the belief that you'd do something with it someday. But that was 3 years ago now, and you have to decide whether it's worth moving to the new house or not. And I know that sounds almost too specific to be hypothetical, but it is. And my answer to this hypothetical scenario is, throw it away. Don't take it with you. It's broken. Get rid of it. And that's what humanity's got to do as we prepare to live on other worlds and continue to live on this one with which Almighty God has so richly blessed us all. We must take a long, hard look at what works and what doesn't before we make the big move and keep what works and throw out what doesn't work. ASAP. For example, love your neighbor as yourself works. Hate your neighbor, degrade them, and kill them if you feel like it doesn't work. It really doesn't. So let's keep the love and get rid of the hate. This is a very good goal for humanity, and it begins with each and every one of us individually. And it's something Christians ought to have down because it's what our Lord Jesus taught us. And in our scripture today, see, here it is. I finally made it. The disciples of Jesus, they are about to blast off into outer space. I mean, outer space to them. See, after they receive the gift of the Holy Spirit, many of them venture off beyond their country and their culture like no one had ever done before. With the Spirit's power, they would carry the good news of Jesus Christ across the globe or around the globe. They would preach the coming of God's kingdom, and countless people would receive faith in Jesus Christ. And yes, it worked, but there were some issues on the launch pad. See, the apostles and the first disciples of Jesus were Jews, because Jesus is the Jewish Messiah. So these Jews had to discern what from their culture ought to be taken with them and passed on to others, and what ought to be kept to themselves as Jews, and what ought to be left behind completely. Basically, the most challenging question for the early church was, do we require people who are not Jews to become Jews in order to be members of the church and have faith in Jesus Christ? Or are there other options? And what made that question so challenging was that the Jewish Christian leaders and others in the church, the apostles, didn't always agree upon which options they ought to take, which caused them to take that long, hard look at which aspects of their culture worked for them and for the global mission, and which didn't. And fortunately, eventually, they found a good, solid, healthy middle ground. So looking at us today, when we embrace the gift of God's Holy Spirit, we embrace the Spirit who has traveled every inch of the universe, roamed every planet, moon, star, comet, asteroid, nebula, the Spirit who participated in the creation of everything and everyone, our neighbors and ourselves. And one day, we'll all be citizens of the same kingdom, God's kingdom. For example, people who some call illegals today will live freely in God's kingdom among the people who call them illegals. That's part of the reason why I think God's kingdom may have a very substantial orientation process. But the thing is, if we want to embrace God's Holy Spirit, we must be prepared to leave behind all that doesn't work. We must be prepared to transcend our country, our culture, our tradition, our prejudices, any attachments that cause us to see anyone as anything less than a beloved child of God. Just as the apostles and the disciples of Jesus did millennia ago, we need another Pentecost. The church must take a long, hard look at what works and what doesn't work, what we take with us on our mission and what we leave behind, and prepare to blast off once again. Amen. And if you would like to blast off as a member of this congregation, yes, you can come forward during our invitation hymn. Jesus rescued. You remember, this is when Jesus drowning. And I saw that. Not, I didn't see somebody drown, but I saw a lifeguard jump in and save a kid at the resort. And that's what normally happens when somebody saves you. They come, they grab you, they pull you out of danger, they pull you out of the water, they pull you out of the fire, they pull you out of the car that's you're pinned under or whatever. In this case, it's almost like Jesus said, "You're drowning, I'll drown for you." He did it for us. So we didn't have to. That's something, I don't know. Nobody else can do that. Only Jesus. He gave his life for us, so we don't have to endure the pain of the punishment for our sins, and we don't have to die, to just cease to exist. We have hope beyond this life. Jesus rescued us from a relatively short, hopeless existence and gave us so much now and so much in the world to come. And one thing we found in our denomination that works is that works for our mission around the world and beyond is to invite everybody to Jesus' table. Because Jesus didn't come to rescue just church members, he came to rescue everybody. So everybody's welcome. So let's enjoy our rescue. For it was on the night when our Lord was betrayed, he took bread, went into the next, he broke it, and he said, "This is my body that is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." And in the same way, after supper, he took the cup. He said, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." For as often as we eat this bread and drink the cup, we proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Please pray with me. Loving and holy Father, we give you thanks that we have been rescued from our sins by our Savior, Jesus Christ. We give you thanks that we get to follow him every day of our lives through the power of your Holy Spirit. And we humbly ask that your Spirit be with us now as we dine at Jesus' table. Bless the elements, the bread, the cup that represent his body and his blood poured out for the forgiveness of our sins. And we ask this in his precious name. Amen. And there are three communion and offering stations here in the sanctuary. One right up here and two at either exit. Come to the table.